the microbes are educated to resist penicillin. In such cases, the thoughtless person playing with penicillin is morally responsible for the death of the man who finally dies to infection with the penicillin-resistant organisms. I hope this evil can be averted. Hello and welcome to Dentistry 101. Today, we're going to be discussing a double-edged sword drug used commonly in the dental field, Antibiotics 101.
Antibiotics are powerful medicine that could fight infections caused by bacteria. They could either kill the bacteria and be considered as bactericidal, or stop the bacteria from reproduction and could be considered as bacteriostatic. It should be noted that before the bacteria could multiply or cause any infection, our immune system could stop these bacteria and kill them. God has created white blood cells which could attack the harmful bacteria and destroy them. However, the number of bacteria could be excessive and the immune system alone could not fight them. In this case, antibiotics might be useful. Antibiotics are available in many different forms, either intravenously or intramuscular or oral or topically. In dentistry, topical application of antibiotics in the form of mouthwashes and using oral administration are the most common routes. Like analgesics, antibiotics have many side effects on the body. There is a very dangerous phenomena which has happened in the past years because of the excessive antibiotic use since the late 1920s. Antibiotic resistance by bacterial mutation became a major concern in the last decades. As the time passes, the excessive use of antibiotics has led to mutant bacteria which are immune to common antibiotics which are used. Most of the bacteria affecting humans will be immune to most of the available antibiotics, and any infection which spreads in the body could be fatal. To prevent this from happening, antibiotics need to be prescribed only in specific cases. Antibiotics act on bacteria by many different ways. They could either inhibit the cell wall synthesis of the bacteria, making the bacteria to rupture, or they could inhibit the metabolic pathway of the bacteria. Other antibiotics cause DNA denaturation of the bacteria, and others could stop the bacteria from production of their proteins, which could stop their nutrition. Antibiotics could be broad spectrum, acting on many different bacteria which could either be gram-positive or gram-negative, anaerobic or aerobic. Penicillins were the first introduced antibiotics in 1928. They were very effective in killing of the bacteria. However, they were made from structure called beta-lactam and could be destroyed by bacteria having the beta-lactamase enzyme. Advances in different antibiotics led to the production of stronger antibiotics which could be resistant to the beta-lactamase enzyme produced by the bacteria. As general dentists, we need to know exactly when to prescribe antibiotics. Most of the dental procedures do not require antibiotics. Prescribing antibiotics will do more harm than benefit and will make the patient more prone to infection because of the resistance, in addition to the side effects. All of the studies have found out that direct intervention by the dentist and removing the source of infection is much more important and effective than prescribing antibiotics. If the bacteria proceeds to the pulp and the patient has severe pain and needs root canal, the pulp becomes necrotic, and giving the patient antibiotics will have no effect on the bacteria because the bacteria inside of the tooth does not have direct blood flow because it's already dead. If the pulp is still vital, it means the bacteria are very weak and the patient also does not need antibiotics. This means in both acute and chronic pulp infection, either the pulp is vital or non-vital, antibiotics will not have any benefit. If the patient does not treat the tooth and do root canal, the bacterial number could increase, causing a dental abscess. This is a true condition of infection. Do we need to prescribe antibiotics in this condition? Some of the physicians will say yes. However, the answer is it depends. In most of the dental abscess cases, when the swelling is localized, it means that the immune system has successfully countered the bacterial infection, and all is left is for the dentist to remove the source of the infection, which is the dead pulp, either by doing root canal or extracting of the tooth.
The swelling and the abscess will go away in few days without the need of any antibiotics. Prescribing analgesics in these conditions is more than enough. Removing of the source of the infection and draining the infection are much more important than giving antibiotics. However, if the patient who has a dental abscess shows signs of spread into the body or shows systemic signs such as fever or headache or malaise or lymph node swelling or swelling of the facial spaces, these symptoms could indicate that antibiotics are indicated because the bacteria are stronger than the immune system, either because of the great number of bacteria or because of the low strength of the immune system of the patient. Removing of the source of the infection and draining the infection are much more important than giving antibiotics. Treating periodontal abscesses, debridement of the pocket, or extraction of the tooth is more than enough. Patients who have aggressive periodontitis or chronic periodontitis are not recommended to be given antibiotics. Root surface debridement and maintaining oral hygiene by the patient is more than enough. In pericoronitis, no antibiotics should be given. The best line of treatment is debridement and irrigation. Management of the dry socket after extraction does not require antibiotics. Irrigate the socket with saline or chlorhexidine and place an alveo gel pack. Concerning giving antibiotics as prophylaxis, which means that sometimes we need to give antibiotics to prevent any infection before the dental procedure, every year the guidelines keep on changing. The use of antibiotics after dental surgery, if the procedure was done by an experienced oral surgeon and the time of the impaction surgery was not much, the operator could decide not to give any prophylactic antibiotics after the surgery. However, if the procedure was long or the patient is at risk of infection, antibiotics could be prescribed after the surgery. Dental implants do not require prophylactic antibiotics either before or after the surgery, unless in people who are prone to infection, such as immunocompromised patients, HIV patients, patients who have cancer or autoimmune diseases or uncontrolled diabetes, or are taking corticosteroid therapy. Antibiotics could also be indicated when removing the source of infection could not be done. For example, when the patient is traveling or when extensive implant placement will be made. These people are recommended to be given antibiotics. Concerning the type of antibiotics that should be given in any dental infection, the first choice is usually amoxicillin, which is effective in most of the dental infections. These are the recommended doses of amoxicillin. If the signs of spread start to go away after 3 days, it could be stopped, or it could be given for 5 days. Metronidazole is more commonly used than amoxicillin in any infection of periodontal origin, or it could be used if patients are allergic to penicillin, or it could be used as an adjunctive antibiotic with amoxicillin. These are the recommended doses of the metronidazole. The use of topical antibiotics in the form of mouthwashes is indicated for the patient to maintain his oral hygiene. The most famous antibiotic mouthwash is the chlorhexidine dicalcuinate. Its excessive use could cause discoloration of the teeth and the oral structures. It is recommended to use chlorhexidine mouthwashes as a prophylaxis before any dental procedure which could have infection, such as oral surgery, removing the wisdom teeth, or implant surgery. Other antibiotics like clindamycin or cephalosporins, or combining amoxicillin with other drugs, do not offer any advantage over the normal amoxicillin, except in infection of periodontal origin, where metronidazole is the first line of treatment. Doxycycline could be used in chronic periodontitis cases to decrease the probing depth. These are the recommended doses. The local use of antimicrobial gels in pockets have proven to have no value. Amoxicillin could be combined with metronidazole in severe dental infections. For people who have kidney problems, the amoxicillin and the metronidazole dose should be reduced to 2/3 only, like giving them to the patient 2 times per day instead of 3 times per day. Or clindamycin could be given because it is more safe for the kidneys. Or it could be used if patients are allergic to penicillin. These are the recommended doses for the clindamycin. Concerning people who have liver disease, amoxicillin is considered safe. Clindamycin and metronidazole should be used in half of the dose. It is recommended to avoid clindamycins, tetracyclines, metronidazoles, and clarithromycins during pregnancy. Some cool facts about antibiotics. Alexander Fleming, the person who discovered antibiotics, was the first person to predict that resistance will happen in the future. It is recommended to eat yogurt during the duration the patient is taking antibiotics because friendly bacteria which stimulate the formation of lactic acid in the stomach is present. The production of the lactic acid will decrease the side effects of antibiotics such as diarrhea. And in general, any fermented food is recommended to be taken during antibiotic use. Eating garlic is recommended during antibiotic use because it contains compounds which could protect the liver and the kidneys from the potential damage by antibiotics. To summarize, antibiotics should only be used when their benefit is more than their harmful effects. Antibiotics are not indicated in most of the cases, unless the patient has a true infection. If the patient shows any signs of spread, antibiotics are indicated as prophylaxis in patients who have a problem in their immune system or when the patients are not able to receive immediate emergency treatment to remove the source of infection. Removing the source of infection and draining the infection by different means such as doing root canals or scaling and curettage and maintaining the oral hygiene of the patient is much more important than antibiotic prescription. If the surgery was simple and did not take time, antibiotics could not be prescribed. Recent researchers suggest that using amoxicillin is the first line of treatment in most of the dental conditions. If the patient is allergic to penicillin or has resistance, metronidazole is the second choice. Metronidazole is the first choice for infections of periodontal origin. Metronidazole and amoxicillin could be combined together in patients who have severe dental infection. If the patient has allergy or resistance to amoxicillin and metronidazole, clindamycin is the drug of choice. Try to avoid giving any antibiotics for pregnant women. The safest antibiotic used during pregnancy and lactation is the amoxicillin. Pregnant women who are allergic to penicillin could be given clindamycin, but with great caution and for a limited time because it could cause problems for the fetus. Metronidazole should be avoided because there is a controversy that it is carcinogenic for the fetus. Tetracyclines are not commonly used in dentistry and should never be given to pregnant women. Patients who have kidney disease, clindamycin is the first drug of choice. For people who have liver disease, amoxicillin is considered to be safe. Clindamycin and metronidazole could be prescribed in half of the doses if the patient has a hypersensitivity from amoxicillin. And this brings an end to our video Antibiotics 101. If you like the video, please hit like and subscribe. Thank you for watching.